Markteconomie, daar zweren we bij tegenwoordig. En ook overheidsbedrijven moeten allemaal in particuliere handen komen, vinden we. De spoorwegen gingen al, de PTT volgde. Alle elektriciteitsbedrijven moeten nu ook naar particulieren toe. Dan worden ze niet alleen commerciëler, maar ook efficiënter en goedkoper voor ons, de klanten. De vraag is of dat altijd zo is. Neem nou een voorbeeld uit de Verenigde Staten. Toch het land van de vrije markten. Het land, het boegbeeld van het kapitalisme. Daar heeft de staat New York de elektriciteitsvoorziening van Long Island, 1 miljoen klanten, overgenomen, teruggenomen van particulieren. Per saldo, power to the people.
Here in Long Island because I was investigating the Long Island Lighting Company, which is the electric company here. My home, and this is the Long Island Sound. People, I think, in Europe would be very, very surprised to learn that America, which is supposed to be the land of free enterprise and free market cowboys, actually has a tremendous amount of public ownership. We have a huge, what you would call a socialist sector. And we just call publicly owned sector. I would say about 78% of our water systems are owned by the public. The private sewer companies are almost all gone. And about a third of the power in America is generated by publicly owned systems. And we're going quite the opposite direction of Europe, which is moving from public to private. We are deprivatizing while you're privatizing.
Well, in the U.S., we've had about 100 years of experience with private companies, quite different than the European experience. So we're very used to figuring out how to regulate these characters. Come on in to my office. And figuring out how to control a privately owned system where profit is the major motivator of what they're doing. So for 100 years, you've had privately owned utilities running alongside government-owned utilities, publicly owned utilities, customer cooperative owned companies. And it's been a battle between the public and the private companies for 100 years. So over that time, we've learned how to regulate them. It's quite different than in Europe. We have, for example, a structure where the government here sets very tight profit caps on the companies. They're not allowed to make very much in the way of earnings. And we control what type of investments they can make, how much they can charge. And so in the U.S., people will be surprised to learn that we don't let the capitalist-owned systems run amok. We keep a very tight control, and therefore our prices are about half of what they are in Europe, despite being private companies. And of course, what's interesting is that in the U.S., public systems are looked at as more efficient. They're looked at as cheaper, so that if you have a public electric company, your prices on average are about 15 to 20% less than they would be if you had a private company. Loco is a Long Island lighting company. The company is, was about 80 years old and had been operating out here among the farms for many years. As the population exploded and moved into the millions as people poured out of New York, they decided to produce power through nuclear plants and try to build one in the middle of the island called Shoreham. When Shoreham was first conceived back in 1964, the company promised us that they could build this thing for $264 million. By the time it was completed,
it cost over $8 billion. So you can imagine this incredible, unbelievable increase in prices. And that, of course, affected the electric rates, and so the public decided to put them out of business.
This way, you'll see why it's stupid to build a nuclear plant here. There's just no way to escape. This is Long Island Sound. There's only two roads that run through Long Island. If anything happened at that nuclear plant, there's no way for 500,000 people to get off the island. People have no problem with nuclear power here. They just want to be able to escape with their lives and their family. We did studies, the government, of what would happen in case of a nuclear accident. We asked the company what would happen if the plant exploded, and people were trying to get back in towards the plant to get their families out. I said, well, what would you do if someone tried to go towards the plant instead of going away from the plant? They said, well, we'd stop them. I said, well, how would you stop them? They said, well, I guess we'd have to shoot them. That type of response, of course, angered the public. And so what happens is that people decided that these guys were just too dangerous to have around.
It's time for News 2.
This is really heavy snow. It's that coastal low that formed yesterday, and anywhere from Suffolk County, where there's a winter storm warning in effect, on into Boston, snow amounts will range from 6 to 8 inches in places, perhaps 10 inches of snow. That's farther up in Massachusetts.
What?
How are you?
How are you, Wayne?
Nice to see you again.
Good to see you.
Nice to see you.
How have you been?
You're pretty good, thanks.
Good. Very good.
We're both friends?
Yes.
Yes.
Known each other for a long time. We were in politics together in Suffolk County for 10 years. The way it worked here was that this is the horseshoe that the county legislature meets at. Several years, I sat right here as the presiding officer. And I was in the Republican Party. Wayne was, he sat a few seats down in his district seat, and we formed coalitions, which was not the usual story in Suffolk County at that time. It was usually on party line in a two-party system. But Wayne and I were very convinced that that was not working. And in fact, things like Lilco were allowed to happen, and Shoreham were allowed to happen without much public involvement. So we formed a coalition between the parties, and as a result of that coalition, citizen involvement was encouraged. And when the citizens got encouraged, who were very irate about not only the financial problems with Lilco and a private utility, but also the safety problems, when that citizenry came forward, it was an open forum for them at last.
The public was invited to come before the Suffolk legislature, to go behind this podium and speak that the Suffolk legislature should fight against Lilco's rate increases and rate increases and rate increases. So they would come here orderly, but one by one, by the scores and the hundreds, to urge the legislature to take a stand. And that's what we did. We formed an alliance with the public to fight Lilco everywhere. And it all started in the local government in Suffolk County.
In 1986, the state legislature, after 2 days of staying in session all night, passed this law, which I originally drafted, which would allow for the purchase of the Long Island Lighting Company. And that just really began the battle. That was 1986. And then we didn't actually make a move for the company, or we didn't succeed until 1991 in actually purchasing the company. It was a pitched battle up until then. What's interesting about this, of course, is that we're in 1986, the U.S. here is moving towards deprivatizing company, which is exact same time that Margaret Thatcher was beginning the move towards privatization in Britain. So we're moving the exact opposite way of Europe. Not only did the public want this law and the average consumer,
But big industry was pushing for it, too. They'd had it with Lilco. In fact, there were huge demonstrations at the nuclear plant, and so it looked like it was a bunch of greens who were trying to put this company out of business. But in fact, when we had these hearings, you're the biggest corporations in New York saying, we're not going to pay for this company anymore. We want a public system, and we want the lowest prices. Very simple question, who could get the job done? It was decided that a publicly owned system is better for running a monopoly than a private system. Utilities, like electricity, are just a totally different animal than other corporations because you're talking about a monopoly necessity. There's really no competition in electricity. Oh, they talk about, well, competition's coming in, you'll get to choose your electric company. That's all phony. They've tried that in Britain, and it's a complete joke. There's only one wire that goes into your house. There's no competition over that wire. It's all accounting games that they play when they talk about competition. So we don't pretend in the U.S. there's competition electricity. So therefore, no one cries about losing a company. No one feels that that means that we are returning to a system of state control over everything. Just these are basic necessities of life, and that's the responsibility of the state, like a street.
At the time that the public participation started, there was a widely held view that we could make no difference, that the decisions were already made, and it was really a fait accompli. However, when the grassroots turbulence began to gain momentum, the politicians on the state and federal level began to get worried. The congressmen, the senators, the assemblymen in the state level, they did not think that there would be any kind of public reaction. They thought that they would roll over and play dead. But that changed when this forum activated and the fire caught on, and people started taking an interest and realizing that they could make a difference. And the amazing thing that happened was a local citizens' movement was able to stop not only a federally sponsored and supported nuclear power plant project, but the public's momentum picked up enough to make sure a public utility took the place of the runaway utility that Lilco had become. And it all started here.
Well, one thing in Europe, you're moving to private companies because there is a grand belief that they're very efficient automatically. As soon as you hear the word market, you say, oh, they must be efficient because there's a profit motive. But in fact, what we found, and this is, for example, right here are some of the papers from an investigation of Lilco, of their competence or incompetence. And what we found in this order is that they spent billions of dollars inefficiently. This review, which ran to several hundred thousand pages of documentation. So we really, you know, looked at every little decision they made, went through their meeting notes, their management notes, and said, how did they make these decisions? We found out that it was one goofy mistake after another. Because they were, the idea that a bunch of executives automatically make brilliant decisions, whereas government executives cannot make efficient decisions, is the latest ideological trend. It's a gimmick. And there's this ideological belief in Europe at the moment that you can create competition in electricity. That's really not possible. It just physically is not possible. You got one wire going to a home, you have a few power plants, you have one national grid structure. We've come to recognize after 100 years in the U.S. that competition is kind of a fantasy. So you got to control. That's the irony. See, right now, you say, well, you've got these big government bureaucracies. Let's get rid of them by having private companies. Well, in the U.S., we have 50,000 people involved in the regulation of utilities. So if you're going to have private companies, you have to have this huge bureaucracy to police them. Let's take a look in here. If you're going to be regulating utilities, this is what you're going to have to come up against. This is some of the Lilco documentation that I
kept, and this is just a small fragment of it, to do the racketeering case and look at the what the utility was doing in terms of nuclear plant, we probably looked at 2 million pages of documentation that we pulled from the company. The companies that are coming to Europe are the same companies I've been investigating here for years. The difference is that in Europe, you don't have anything like this. In the U.S., the companies have to turn over all their documents to the government and to the public. In other words, if I see a document and I'm working for the government, I actually have to make it available to anyone in the public that wants to see it. Now, you have no such system set up yet anywhere in Europe, and therefore you've got a real problem, because I don't know how you can control these companies unless you have these documents. These are all the account records. These are the internal meeting memoranda of the company. And you have to have this stuff. Otherwise, the prices are going to go through the roof and the profits are going to go crazy. At the end of my street, where the new public system has put up new wiring, and they've also cut back the trees. This is maintenance that was deferred by Lilco for 10 years. We used to have blackouts here. Now that's ended, and we had real battles with this company over it. They laid off 1,500 people here, and the regulators made them give the savings back to the public. But in the meantime, of course, our lights are going out.
Dedicated, caring, brave. But at LIFA, the words we use to describe ourselves are these: doing our job. LIFA, a change for the better.
Well, I've been involved in the Lilco Shoreham issue for probably 25 years. So I've been kind of seeing this thing from the beginning to where it is now. And it's really an amazing thing, because if you told me even 5 years ago that Lilco would be gone, LIPA would be the electric company, you know, I would never have believed it. And obviously the biggest change is people are paying less for electricity on Long Island, significantly less, 20% less, which is a huge number. And, you know, if you accumulated that over Long Island on a year's basis, about $500 million that they were paying to Lilco that they're not paying to LIPA. Why are we more efficient? I think we're more efficient because we do things in public. You know, when you have an investor-owned utility, the board of directors of that company, like Lilco, meets in secret. And, you know, one day they come out and say, we're building Shoreham, or we're not going to spend money on energy conservation. So I think that when you do things in public, you become more efficient.
What do you think of the change?
Good.
Yeah?
Yeah.
What do you think of the new owners versus the old?
Right now, it really doesn't feel that much difference.
Uh-huh.
It really is too soon to tell.
But, right. Were you here when during that period when people seemed to hate all local workers?
Oh, yes. Oh, yeah.
And there was a time, actually, when they took the local signs off the trucks.
I wasn't there then. I don't think they ever did that. But,
yeah.
There was some times during the Shoreham issues and stuff like that we wasn't... But, you know, when people are out of lights, though, they kind of like you no matter who you are, you know, if you're putting them back with them. You know, so.
Well, thanks a lot.
Okay, take care.
Here's the problem with capitalism and electricity. When you're an investor-owned utility, you have to serve two masters, right? I mean, you have to serve the shareholders, because you got to make a profit so they get their dividends, and you have to serve the ratepayers. And so what you do when you're an investor-owned utility is, when you're with your customers, you say, we're going to keep those rates as low as possible. But when you're with your shareholders, you say, we're going to raise those rates so we can give you bigger dividends. I think it's a conflict of interest. Now, it's not true with everything. Where there's competition, where you can ship things all over the place, you know, capitalism is wonderful. I'm not so sure it's so great with electricity, though. You want to know what matters to people? I'll tell you what matters to people. This is what the wallet. This is what matters to people.
And, you know, in the end, if you want to talk philosophy, they don't want to hear that. If you want to talk that we're putting $50 a month in their pocket that they would have paid to Lilco, I think they like the deal.
Hey, how you doing? Let me start with a cup of coffee. Perfect.
Our local diary.
How old are the children?
They're great.
It's getting big, I bet. Huh?
Yeah.
Did you get your $100 check?
Yes.
Uh-huh. So what are you paying now?
Well, I have oil heat.
Uh-huh.
So my electric bill is probably about $80 a month.
$80. What was it before?
$110.
So you went from $110 to $80?
Yeah.
And you got the check.
And I got my check. And it's now, in the bank. It's in the bank. I put all the money away.
I saw the guys. In a way, it's a shame, but they're finally trimming the trees. But, you know, they really hacked back on our street.
By us?
Soundview. But have you been, we used to have a lot of outages and kind of stopped. What's happened? Have you seen any difference?
I can't say that. Years ago, yeah. Oh, my God. We used to get a little thunder and lightning, and they put us out. But since they changed, I don't know, they got better lines or something?
I think to go from public power in Europe to private power without at least those regulatory bodies in place with aggressive regulations would be a terrible mistake. And then if you go to private utilities, in the absence of active, vibrant, competitive markets, then you're looking for a tragedy to develop. And before I would go from public to private, I would make sure those things are in place first.
So if you're going to make a big decision like this in your country about turning public power into private power, you have got to make sure that information gets out and that it continues to get out so that blurred truth and questionable facts don't lead to bad decisions.
Thank you very much.
Thank you. Good luck.
I'm not so sure people are going to like privatization. I really think, again, it sounds good. But you know what? Here's the bottom line. If everything goes private and rates go up, people are not going to like it. Now, you want my prediction? My prediction is that once you go over to private, despite the fact that they'll talk about competition and efficiencies, not going to happen. I mean, you're going to see rates. Maybe they'll go down a little bit at first. They'll go up. And people are going to be angry about it. So you know what? Maybe 10 years from now, Europe will come back and join us.
My personal story is that I, you know, grew up working class. And the great irony is that I'm a student of Milton Friedman and George Stigler, who won Nobel Prizes for their work in libertarian free market theory, that the state should own nothing and the state should do nothing. One of the things you could say about the deprivatization in the U.S. because of its wealth, the Americans here demand their rights. They don't believe that the New World Order applies here. It's something that American consultants sell to the Europeans or impose upon Latin America. No one knows about this here. It's almost a strange secret that America is not the free market, free enterprise state that we project to the rest of the world. Here we demand low prices, here we demand public control, and so what we sell to the rest of the world in terms of free market theories does not apply here. If there's anything to learn out of the battle that we've had right here in Long Island that you can take back across here to Europe, it's that ultimately private companies are going to grab the money out of the wallets of the public if there's a monopoly. And the only way to break that is for the public to regain control and ownership of the public systems.
Volgende week in Persaldo de Nederlandse tomatenteelt. Die heeft het moeilijk, want de Spaanse rukt op. De tuinder vecht terug met nieuwe soorten en grote bedrijven. Zal dat voldoende zijn?